of these, this particular subject, if you will, would stay with me to the very end. God has a word for you today through the teaching of his word. First, would you go with me to prayer and ask God through a word today? So let us pray. God, we love you. We thank you for what all you continue to do. God, without you, we can truly do nothing. And through you, God, we can do all things in your will. God, we thank you for what your will is, God. Your word be magnified today. Your word be followed. God, let us aspire for greatness in you to see your kingdom come and your will be done. God, let us learn about your word today. Give us ears to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. The mission of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. I was at Savannah, Georgia, and we were at a place, and it was a place dedicated to the Mighty 8 Air Force Museum. And walking in the rotunda of that building, there was a backdrop that said, "The Soldier." And it was a very short, to the point about a soldier laying down his life. He did it for his country, for his brethren. And I was moved when I read that. And, you know, when you walk and live and move and have your being in Jesus, you know, really it's Jesus is everything. You see Jesus in everything. You magnify and glorify him in everything. Like, so you see that he's a firm foundation we walk on. You know, the cornerstone of a building, you look at a building, you're like, you know, you see things. Start to magnify God every moment. And so the mission of Jesus, he was the Father, invisible, omnipresent spirit that related to angels and men through a spirit image. And he robed himself in an incarnate baby. And then he was the sacrificial lamb. This was amazing. As a picture of him dying on a battlefield, so to speak, in dying on a battlefield for his brethren, for mission, and he was ultimately victorious in that mission. He made a conquest of death, hell, and the grave. That he spoiled the enemy's tactics, goods. He came and took death captive. So he definitely had a mission. He fulfilled his mission. And what a wonderful conquest that was, as he made a way when there was no way. Through the sentence of death, he came to make a propitiation or an atonement, or he's still a way maker that we might be saved. Hallelujah. So the mission of Jesus Christ, the omnipresent spirit, invisible spirit, the creator of all, became manifested in the flesh. Let's go to 1 Timothy 1:17, if you want to reference that. 1 Timothy 1:17. In John chapter 4, verse 24. Jeremiah 23, 24. And 1 Kings 22:19. This would relate to you, the Father, invisible, omnipresent spirit, related to angels and men through the spirit image. So praise the Lord. And then we're going to the Father's plan, his word. Then his word became flesh, the Son of God. Then the Son to redeem from sin and our example. The Old Testament will flip to the New Testament, where he's on his throne. He'll rule for a thousand years with his saints. He'll soon catch away the recreated believers. The Christ's present ministry as high priest, intercessor, mediator, and advocate. Then the Father's Spirit sent to recreate and baptize all who believe and obey the gospel. We'll see the Father in creation, the Son in redemption, and the Holy Spirit in recreation as the one true Jesus Christ, the Yeshua, the Yahweh, manifested in flesh. It's an amazing thing. We'll go to that first scripture, if you would, that 1 Timothy 1:17. I want to give honor to my pastor today, Pastor Waldron. We had a blowout church service today with a guest minister from Stone Mountain. Was privileged to hear the word of God there. All right, let's see, 1:17. unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever. Amen. Amen. So now the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God. The only wise God is also referred to in Jude, which is just a couple verses down. This is in Jude 25. Is that right? Jude 25. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, power, both now and forever. Amen. It's a precious, precious word of God that we're reading today. See, I lost my place. Praise the Lord. We'll go into that scripture. So, you know, in these times, the enemy would like for deception, and his tactic is to deceive, and just who God is, who God's identity is, what his mission is, and if he can get people off a couple degrees from who God is, the Godhead, then he successfully accomplished his mission. Can the mystery of the Godhead be understood? Yes. Here's Romans chapter 1, verse 20. It can be understood that when we were all created, we know God, we can see his creation, that undeniably we know that there is a God. In Colossians 2:9, for all the fullness of the Godhead dwells in Jesus bodily, we can know the mystery of the Godhead. Here's 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. He was received of the glory, without controversy, great is the mystery of this. you charge these to memory, and sometimes you have to slow down. Let's see, the mystery of godliness, that God was manifest in the flesh, received and ultimately received of the glory. We might go to that scripture in just a second. Let's see, going back to my original verse here. I had a chart I was following. We're still trying to search out that chart. Bless the Lord. Yeah, so God's faithful even to the very end. God wants to know, God wants to be known, and God wants you to know him accurately. The predication of your worship, God wants you to worship him in spirit and in truth. So we're talking about the Old Testament, the mission of God. So the Father's plan of creation, his word. In the beginning, let's see, we'll go to Genesis chapter 1. Verse 1. Our lives, we have a beginning. Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. God is the Alpha and the Omega. So it's rightful when we talk about the Godhead to go to the book of beginnings, who God is. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God divided the light. Praise the Lord. So our aim is to see the light, and if people don't see the light, hopefully they can feel the heat before they see the light. Let's see, 1 through 3, Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And so God moved upon the face of the water. The Spirit of God, the invisible Spirit of God, moved upon the face. As it says, the face of the deep. The earth was without form and void. Darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water. So God's mission. God moves upon something that's... God moves upon the face of the waters. It didn't have any form. It was void. There was darkness there. No matter what you're going through today, God is still that Spirit that can go in and out through walls. God can go where there's a border, where there's prison camps. God can still move without form and void. God can go places. So if you think that your life is hopeless, if you think it's void, still God's mission to seek and save those who are lost. The Father's plan, so God wants to habitate. God wants to create a place for you to live. There's places that God wants you to live. So God is a provider. Let's go to Psalm 33, verse 6. Psalm directly in the middle of the Bible, reference one, 33, verse 6. And by the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the hosts of them by the breath of his mouth. The reality that God speaks the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and all the hosts of them by the breath of his mouth. But what a wonderful thing. We have to take God's word at full face value, that by his very word, things stand at attention. If things are gathered together and still adhere to his command, God's word goes forth, and the known laws of physics, they're at attention to God's word. They still stand in perfect obedience and reverence to God. And this scripture is Psalm 33, verse 6. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the hosts of them by the breath of his mouth. And he gathered the waters of the sea together as a heap, and he layeth up the depth in storehouse. And let all the earth fear the Lord, and let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. Not them, the singular God by himself. The word of the Lord, the heavens were made. And the Lord bringeth the counsel of heavens to naught, and he maketh the devices of the people of none effect. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the thoughts of his heart to all generations. The reason why we still have the Bible today, the reason why the enemy fights it so much, because it still stands today. For all generations, God preserves his word, and through the Gutenberg presses, 1480, all the way throughout the centuries, you've got perfected print, then from print to different forms of media. God still is doing that through podcasts, through social media platforms, even through telephone. Bless the Lord, God's still doing a miracle of getting his plan out, what his mission is. Let's go to Psalm 148. Verse 4 through 5. Psalm 148. 4 through 5. Psalm 148. 4 through 5. All right, amen. Let us praise him, ye heavens and of heavens, and ye waters that be above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord. He commanded, and they were created. The Lord. We know the Lord today from the New Testament to present time, or from the Old Testament to present day. The Lord. Let's see. Will God give his glory to another? No. Was there a God born before Jehovah? No. We know the Lord. Let's see. How many gods should we know? There's only one. Hosea 13:4. Let's reference that. Hosea 13:4. Let have somebody read from time to time. That's in the minor, what they call the minor prophets. We're getting there. It just takes a minute to get there. Hosea 13:4. Yet I am the Lord thy God from the land of Egypt, and thou shalt know no God but me. For there is no savior beside me. I did know thee in the wilderness and in the land of great drought. So here we go. So the Lord, there's only one. I am the Lord thy God from the land of Egypt. There's no savior beside me, but saith the Lord. Hosea 13, verse 4. So the Lord, we know him as numerically being one. His plan, he formed the universe. Let's see Hebrews 13, verse 3. I'm sorry, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3. Hebrews. A pastor would say that God likes coffee, because Hebrews is in the Bible. Was that Hebrews 13, 3? Says, this is the chapter of faith, the great hall of fame of faith. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things that do appear. So through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. You know, one of these days, one of us should write a book. These construction terminology, frame, we know Jesus as being the son of the carpenter in the New Testament. How in Holy Writ, there the wording, it's about construction and framing of the plumb line, and another a reference to Scripture, he lays the plumb line. That's what another off the cornerstone of a building, they mark it level and perfectly plumb the plumb line. So there's a lot of terminology in that, but we're leaving that scripture to go into the next topic heading. But through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. So the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. So God is invisible, and God moved upon the face of the water. Invisible spirit form did that. So God in spirit did that. His word became flesh, the Son of God, the Son of Man. So God is a spirit. You cannot see him unless he chooses to be seen. And when he does, that term is called a theophany. God will show up, and in Moses' day, it was a burning bush. The bush was not consumed, spoke to Moses. There was a dove that came out of the sky during Jesus' baptism. That was another theophany. You go to the ocean, you dip in the ocean, the cup, you can look at the cup, you can see the ocean. Everything the ocean is in the cup. Everything deity was in Jesus Christ. But nevertheless, God still on his throne. The same kind of principle there, the same analogy. The ocean is in the cup, but the ocean is still in the ocean. So God was still on the throne, but in the face of Jesus as well. So God manifested in the flesh. The mission of Jesus Christ, we're getting to this, the mission of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Have to know who we're talking about first. Let's see. The Bible does say there's one Lord. There's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 5. How many God qualities were in Jesus? All the qualities of God were in Jesus. For all the fullness of the Godhead bodily in Jesus. And many rejected him in his day. Many rejected him. He didn't come up as a leader to overthrow the Roman government. As many people idolized him, the Messiah, as being. He didn't do that. He made himself with no reputation. So, let's see. Let's go to Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Thank you for following along, your reverence for the Word of God. We're going to go through this lesson together. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. The physician Luke here records, and it's in red letter, the Word of God. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of the sight to the blind, to set liberty at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. We have the Word becoming flesh, the Spirit of God becoming flesh. Let's see. Did I jump? No, I didn't jump ship. I'm still in the ship, praise the Lord. The Word became flesh. Let's go to Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. Galatians 4, verse 4 says, but when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that they might receive the adoption of sons. Because, and this was a church written in, this was a book written from an apostle to the church in Galatia. So this church had already experienced Pentecost. This church had already was Acts 2:38 compliant. They were baptized in Jesus' name. Let's see, Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that they might receive the adoption of sons. But because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. When you get the Spirit of God in you, you'll be crying, Abba, Father. The Spirit of the Lord, the Father. Wherefore art thou no more servant, but a son, and if a son ye are, then an heir of God through Christ. Howbeit, when you knew not God, you did service unto them which by nature are no gods. But now, after ye have known God, or rather are known of God, how do ye turn again to the weak and beggarly elements whereunto ye desire to be in bondage? Ye observe days, months, times, and years. And the Apostle Paul said, I am afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. He says, brethren, I beg you, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as ye are. And and ye have not injured me at all. And he says, ye know how through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at first. And little children, he says again, he says in verse 19, my little children, of whom I travailed in birth again, and so Christ be formed in you. Hallelujah. So Christ be formed in you. The Word became flesh. And he's saying, so the God be formed in you. John chapter 1, verse 14. So the mission of God is that he be formed in you. The mission of Jesus Christ, that he would be formed in you. John chapter 1, verse 14. John chapter 1, verse 14. Praise the Lord. I'm thankful to be in the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of truth. Thank you, Jesus, for your word. Thank you for your grace and mercy. And John chapter 1, verse 14 says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The Word became flesh, and they beheld his glory, and the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John witnessed the witness of Christ. John bear witness of him, cried, saying, this he that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And John was a humble servant, heralding, he was a forerunner. John Baptist was a forerunner of Jesus Christ, of baptizing people. Now Jesus came, and the baptism has to continue to roll on. We have to be baptized in Christ. We have to put on Christ, be baptized, so Christ be formed in us. He has to be formed in us, the hope of glory. Praise the Lord. So the Word became flesh. Matthew 1:21-23. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord by the prophet. Behold, a virgin shall be filled with child, shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. So we have God with us. Hosea 13, verse 4, a while ago we read, there's only one Lord. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, the Israelites knew that there was one God. Jewish monotheism, one God. They would never worship any other number, not two persons, not three persons, not a polytheistic type framework. They would always be worshiping the one true God. Let's see. So, does the Bible say that Jesus is the Almighty? Yes. Not the one-third mighty, not a fractional Jehovah Junior. But does the body say that, does the body of the Bible say that Jesus is the Almighty? And if so, where can that be found? We can find that in Revelation 1:8. Jesus is the Almighty. What's Jesus' mission as the Almighty? I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and was and which is to come, the Almighty. It's amazing. The Almighty defines itself as being all power and strength. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18, we'll look at the scripture there. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18. Let's go to verse 17. So 2 Corinthians 6, verse 17. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and shall be sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. So I'll be a father to you, saith the Lord Almighty. I will come unto you, and receive you to myself, if you be separate from the world. Come out from among them and be separate. This is the same typological, this is the same imagery of leaving out of Egypt from bondage. The children of Israel had to leave out and be separate. They were baptized unto a cloud. All Moses, the children of Moses, I believe scripture says, they had to come out from among them and be separate. Right, so we're going to go through from the Old Testament to the New Is Jesus the true God? Is he known as the true God? Well, yes, we can see that. We can see that in 1 John. 1 John 5:20. I'm thankful for the men and brethren and those who accompany teaching the truth of God's word throughout all the generations, that it's reached us as prophetically spoken in God's word. He preserved his word throughout all generations for all. So this is 1 John 5, verse 20. Is Jesus the true God? And we know the Son of God has come, and he hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true. And we are in him that is true, even the Son, his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God, the eternal life. Little children, keep yourself from idols. Amen. So this is the true God. Let's go to... there's just so much in there. So much in there to reference the one true God. This is John chapter 3, verse 18. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten God. Jesus, the only name given under heaven, whereby man must be saved. Hallelujah. Some people would never bow. Some people would never bend. There's that rebellion. There's the rebellion that they've already made imagery and idols of their own. But the word says that we have to continue to believe and have faith. Hallelujah! But we have to continue to bow to these Jesus, because believe it or not, all knees will bow before Jesus and confess. Hallelujah. So we're believing that Jesus Christ will become of effect to many, a multitude of people, that they will humble themselves before God and say, what must we do to be saved? What must we do to be saved is still the mission of God. God wants to save you today. We're going to continue to herald the truth, God's word. So, God was manifest in the flesh. The Father, the invisible Spirit, God's plan, God's word became flesh. And now God wants to redeem people from sin and be an example. This is Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Luke 4, verse 18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel unto the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted and to preach deliverance to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Acceptable year of the Lord. This is the acceptable year of the Lord. Well, I have to abruptly close. And in closing, we know that the Father was in creation. God moved upon the face of the deep. The Father in creation. Hallelujah. The Son in redemption. And the Holy Ghost in regeneration. Let's see. The Father in creation, Malachi 2:19. The Son in redemption, Galatians 4, verse 4 through 5. And the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit in recreation. Or regeneration. John chapter 3, 3 through 5. And John chapter 7, 38 through 39. Yeshua, Yahweh, Jesus Christ, out of those wells of living water we still draw up. So I hope that today's lesson you were able to draw up waters of refreshing, identity of Jesus Christ, God manifested in flesh, to the identity of God Almighty, to the only wise God, Jesus Christ. I hope I was able to lead you to that water so you could drink from the well that he promised. Out of the well shall never thirst again. God's birth, Jesus' birth, his crucifixion and his ascension. God rules and reigns on his throne. There'll be a white throne judgment from his great seat. He will rule on earth with his saints for 1,000 years after the rapture. He will catch away. He'll catch away the believers. Praise the Lord. So he'll catch away his believers, and then he'll rule on the earth for 1,000 years. Then there'll be a great white throne judgment. So the Father's Spirit was sent to recreate and to baptize all those who believe and obey the gospel. This is Acts 2:38. The gospel started on the day of Pentecost. The day of Pentecost, the birthday of the church, the foundation, the heritage of the church triumphant, started the book of Acts. The Acts of the Apostles, the actions of the Apostles, they were all in unified agreement. They were all in unison. As a great leader, make sure his subordinates are all in unity and one accord. They were in one accord preaching the day of Pentecost. 3,000 people were obedient to the faith, and God added to the church daily such to be saved. The church that great Almighty God inaugurated continues to ablaze today in fire by the Spirit of God. And we're today heralding the mission of Jesus Christ, his identity. So the Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, and all the mysteries of God be known to you today. In Jesus' name, the Lord bless you, keep you, your family. Until next time.